When we as NASCAR fans look back at the 2000s and early 2010s, there are tons of extremely talented drivers that we look back and talk about. And after going past the usual suspects, we inevitably look at Casey Kane, old Blue Eyes. Kane is a peculiar driver overall. Not too flashy on the track, but still extremely talented. But it's hard to put a finger over how good he actually was. If you look at his stat line, it doesn't have as full of numbers as others, but it's still quite good. 18 wins, 93 top 5s, 176 top 10s, and 27 poles as well. So, with all of this being done in just over 14 and a half seasons in the Cup Series, it's a pretty good career. And it overall can be split into two main halves. Half in the 9 car from 2004 to 2010, and about half in the Hendrick 5 car from 2012 to 2017. There also are two outlier years that can be added in as well. 2011 with Team Red Bull, and 2018 with Levine Family Racing. So let's start off with his early years in the 9 car. The 9 was owned by Ray Evernham and was driven by Bill Elliott from 2001 to 2003, and in this car, Elliott had a bit of a career resurgence right at the end of his time as a full-time driver. Points finishes of 15th, 13th, and 9th respectively and consecutively were matched with 4 wins. In 2001, he broke a 7-year winless streak. So Kane would not only be replacing the most popular driver, he would also be replacing the most popular driver in a winning race car. And after 2 years of driving in the Xfinity Series, Evernham and Elliott deemed the 23-year-old ready to go for Cup. His first career Cup start would be the 2004 Daytona 500. And while it didn't go well at first, he would fight for the win against defending champion Matt Kenseth next week.
Changes lanes. Here comes Kane on the outside.
Just can't quite man it right there off of turn 2.
McMurray almost hit the wall exiting 2 and drops back.
Yeah, he lost a lot of ground right there. Last time through 3 and 4, though. Here they come.
Kane comes to the bottom.
Kane comes to the bottom.
He gets the run. He's got a good run on him. Side by side of the line. Kenseth.
Told you it'd be a Fococo finish.
Matt Kenseth wins the Subway 400.
While the second place loss was a bit of a heartbreaker, the rookie did show that it was only a matter of time before he got his win. But again, he would finish second. And then again. And again. And again, again. Kane had 5 second place finishes in 2004 with no victories. Those 5 top 5s contributed to his 13 total in that year. Only 3 other drivers had more top 5s in 2004 than the competitive rookie. With numbers like that, he'd have to be a championship contender, right? Nope. And simply, it was because of one number that was actually extraordinarily high. His 7 DNFs. This began a common trend for Kane's career overall. Consistent inconsistency. As for 2004, he finished 13th in points and missed the chase. 2005 would show what would have happened had his speed in that season went away. It also didn't help that he DNF'd in literally a quarter of his 2005 starts. But there was finally a bright point to it all at the Richmond International Raceway that spring.
Kane's young racing life right here, and no pressure from behind. He took over the number 9 from legend Bill Elliott. He served as his mentor for a season, and now it's all his own. Off turn 4, Casey Kane is a winner at last.
Even so, his DNFs, 9, were more than his number of top 10s, 8. 2006 would see the peak of Casey Kane's career. Kane would score his highest amount of wins, top 5s, top 10s, poles, and laps led in this season. He was a master of the intermediates that season, with wins at Atlanta, Texas, Charlotte, Michigan, Fontana, and then Charlotte again for the sweep. Like 2004, he had the speed to contend, but unlike that campaign, he actually broke through and made the chase. This would be derailed, though, by 4 finishes outside of the top 30, 33rd or worse in all of them. This only led into what 2007 and 2008 would become as the team and driver overall would fall off. In 2007, he'd fall off the map, scoring an abysmal 22.2 average finish and winding up 19th in points. And while scoring two wins and the All-Star race win, he would miss the chase again in 2008 by 69 points. Nice. Now, in the 2008 and 2009 offseason, Evernham would merge teams with Richard Petty and Petty Enterprises to form Richard Petty Motorsports, the same RPM that we have today. And while scoring the same amount of wins with 2 and top 10s with 14, Kane actually managed to make a successful season out of this, qualifying for the 2009 chase and finishing 10th in points. The key was his increase in top 5s and increase on lead lap finishes. 2010 would be Kane's last year in the 9 car, and it was a forgettable year. For the first time since 2007, he went winless. And by the end of the season, he was actually racing for Team Red Bull, his temporary home for 2011. We'll get more on that later. So in the 9 car, Kane made 247 starts, scored 11 wins, 49 top 5s, 86 top 10s, 19 poles, and led 3,011 laps in 7 seasons. The best that he finished in the points would be 8th in 2006. So while these stats aren't exactly great, it did show flashes of brilliance for Kane. And this really helped pique people's interest in how well he would perform at Hendrick Motorsports in 2012. Well, the answer was that he was really friggin' good at Hendrick, at least in the first year. After starting off the season terribly, I mean sitting 31st in points terribly after 6 races, he would explode in performance, scoring 2 wins as well as 19 top 10s that year. And after a mostly successful chase, Kane would get the best points finish of his career, 4th. In all statistical categories, this would be Kane's best season with Hendrick. Quite literally, there was nowhere to go but down from here. In 2013, he scored 2 more wins, and this time he stayed in the chase field throughout the season. But when it mattered most, he folded, finishing 12th in the points. While some could argue that 2013 was a sophomore slump, 2014 was where people started to worry. Overall, Hendrick Motorsports had been the best team in the sport. Jeff Gordon, Dale Jr., and Jimmy Johnson all won 4 races apiece and were considered championship contenders, while Kane only nabbed 1 win. He finished 15th out of a 16-man chase grid. 2015 saw the trend down continue, and it continued into a downward spiral. He would miss the 16-driver chase, go winless, and finish 18th in points. He also led only 66 laps, the lowest in his career. And 2016 would actually get worse. Again, he went winless, and again, he missed the chase. And this time, he did finish a little better in 17th in points. But he spent no time in the front. I mean, no time. He led 0 laps. It was the first season of his career that he wouldn't lead a single lap. By 2017, it was clear that the 37-year-old was cooked, and he was in the middle of the ending of his competitive career. So, the season would be his swan song at Hendrick Motorsports. It would be highlighted by a win of attrition at the Brickyard. It was his final career Cup Series win.
Great restart for the 5 of Casey Kane. Can he hold it on the bottom of the track? Kane gets by him! Smoke rolling out behind the 11. Casey Kane in front of the 2 of Brad Keselowski. They go down the backstretch. Still smoke coming out of the 11. He gets up the racetrack. And the 11 goes around. They wreck behind him. Did they get to the overtime line? They haven't got there yet. Has the caution come out yet? Now the caution comes out.
From 2014 to 2017, Kane scored as many top 5s as he scored in 2012 alone. 12. At HMS, he made 216 starts. He won 6 times. Finished in the top 5 35 times, got 73 top 10s, 5 poles, and he led 1,284 laps in 6 seasons. Now, it may seem like I didn't cover his Hendrick tenure as much, but the truth is, there really wasn't as much to cover. Kane was almost exclusively the weak link at Hendrick for 6 years. He did no better at Hendrick than he did racing at Ray Evernham's team. In fact, he probably raced better at Evernham's team. To say that it was a disappointment would be an understatement. Now, there are two outlier seasons that flank the Hendrick era. Due to being signed 2 years early, Kane had to race for Team Red Bull for the 2011 season. For being such a last-minute deal and with a dying team, his 2011 season actually was a relative success. Kane was up front most weeks, but due to numerous different situations and issues, he would only score one victory at Phoenix. Like I said, with all things considered, this was actually a pretty good season, even if he didn't make the chase. Now fast forward 7 years to 2018, and it's a much different story as Kane raced for Levine Family Racing. LFR at this time was just not ready to run up front yet. The combination was bound to be a failure overall for Kane. He only had one finish over 15th place, a fourth place run at Daytona after most of the field crashed out. In August, he announced that 2018 would be his final season. Little did most know, and probably did he know, that this would only last a few more weeks. His final race would be him finishing with severe dehydration at Darlington, finishing 24th, three laps down. It was part of an underlying health issue that his doctors deemed would give him permanent damage to his body had he continued to race in Cup. It was an unceremonious end to a relatively good career. So looking at all of this, how does his career really shape up? How good was Casey Kane? Kane was a mid-pack driver on average, who, when excelling, would be a force to be reckoned with. He never had a single season with 20 top 10s or more. He never competed for a championship, really. And he had a large problem taking care of his equipment. Of his 69 DNFs, 53 of them were crashes. Now, this doesn't mean that Kane was a bad driver. He scored more than 10 top 5s 4 times. He made the chase or playoffs 6 times. And his 18 career wins puts him within the top 50 NASCAR Cup Series drivers on the all-time win list. Overall, he had a more successful career in Cup than most. So with that being said, I want to pass this topic on to you. How good do you think Casey Kane was? Let me know down in the comments below. And while you're at it, leave a like on this video and subscribe to my channel for more great NASCAR content. And until next time, have a good one.